never empty. Knowing your love, you're never alone. May your tears come from laughing. You find friends worth having. Every year passing, they mean more than gold. May you win but stay humble. Smile more than grumble. And know when you stumble, you're never alone. Never.
with you. Welcome to worship this morning. Great to have you here. We got a whole passel full of Braxley fans over here for a baptism this morning, the Fiala family, and so it's great to have them here and all that. It's great to have Tori and Matt in the front row. The seats are cheaper in the front, you know. I mean,
very risky.
Very risky, yeah. That's true. It is. It's true. Well, I'm glad that you are here. It's great to have you here. And it's great to have everyone here. I want to thank you for being here this morning. Friday was the retirement party for Ann and I. Many of you were there. Thank you for all that you did that way and all that happened there. I would like to introduce a couple of people to you that are with us this morning. One is Ann's brother and his wife, Bob and Janet. They're clear in the back row back there. Raise your hands. That's Ann's brother.
They're in an escape spot.
They're in an escape spot. And the other couple is right here is Jerry and Glendine Heinert. They're from South Dakota. Bob and Janet are from Montevideo, Minnesota. And Jerry and Glendine are from Delmont. I can never remember. I always think Mission because that's where your mom was. And yeah, Delmont, South Dakota. And so it's good to have them there. Now, Sean, the people I introduced are all Lutherans. Sean's Catholic. So Sean, I didn't realize that the Lutherans believe in God too. It's like the same thing. I didn't know that till recently. You know, it's like, wow, you know, go figure. Now Diane's a Lutheran. And I've always questioned about her relationship with God. I mean, that's she's one of our resident Lutherans. Dennis, we're picking on you too. You know, right here. Yeah. Well, it's great to have all of you here. Thanks for being here this morning. We've got a baptism, we've got some worship, and we're going to have a good time, and it's going to be great to be here. And so thanks for joining us this morning. I don't think I have any other announcements, do I? Except there's going to be a little luncheon afterwards because we've got some leftovers. And so make sure and grab coffee and or sandwiches or whatever is back there. And after the worship and fellowship with one another, that'll be great to do. And Denise, where did you? You're in the back. Denise and Jan, hello. Any other announcements that we need to talk about that's coming up? Nope, they're silent. Put an X on the calendar. Those two are silent for worship. So
there is an anniversary celebration.
Whoops. Okay. Okay. No.
Mary and Larry Hardesty, they've been around a long time, but they're having their open house for their 65th wedding anniversary this afternoon at the Women's Club. So all are welcome from 2 to 4.
Thank you for reminding me of that. Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, Larry and Mary. Mary's a sister to Shirley, who's walking in the door now. So, yeah. Come on in, Shirley. Big day this afternoon for you. So that also reminds me that Jerry and Glendine celebrated 56 years on Friday, you know, and they did it here with us instead of at home with their kids. All of you, happy Father's Day. That's a meaningful type thing, and it means different things in different ways, but we do have kind of a cool little video to show you, and then I'm going to follow up with a prayer for that as we get started. So, and this is meant to be, well, you know, it's a skit guys thing. So, find the humor and also find the message because it's there. So enjoy.
Dad, do you love?
I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love my brother?
Connor? I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love God?
Yeah.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love Dad?
I do.
How much? I gotta go.
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, how much is a gob?
Let me put it like this. Favorite color is yellow. And when you eat those nutty butter cookies,
is you always scrape the peanut butter out of the middle and you secretly feed it to the dog because you think the dog deserves a treat too. At nighttime, I know before you go to bed, you always pull your Barbies all together because you don't want them to be lonely. And sometimes when you get a little nervous, you bat your eyes like this, get really, really, really fast. But when you're happy and you're excited, you always twirl your hair right beside your ear. And you love your mama's red earrings. And you always seem to eat your green beans one at a time. I say, my love, I notice you. And I love being your daddy. And I will always be here for you. Even on your best days, even on your worst days, your daddy loves you and will always be here for you. And that, my dear, that's what a dog is.
I love you too, Daddy.
Let's pray. Almighty God, we observe, we honor fathers on this day, and for each of us, that means something different. I was lucky to have a great dad, and many of us are. And some of us have different relationships with our fathers, and they're not always that great. And we ask that you'd be with those today as well. There are dads that feel guilty for whatever it is in parenting, because that goes hand in hand. God, be with us today as we work through those feelings. But help us, God, to remember that there are dads out there that are doing the best they can. There are dads that we love and dads that we cherish, and we are grateful for those. And you, God, are our ultimate Father, and we're glad for you. Thank you for being with us in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay. I would ask you to stand and join me in our gathering prayer. Spirit of wisdom, wait a minute. I have the wrong one.
Not my fault.
That's what you gave me.
My fault.
As the deep calls to the deep. In thundering waves of faith and steadfast love, so we stand on the mountain with Elijah, feeling billowing waves of God's power flowing over and through us. So set aside your enemies, the people, thoughts, times, and challenges that separate you from knowing God's love. Clothe yourselves in Christ, shout praises in his name, and declare how much God has done for you. Our opening hymn today is Freely, Freely. It's in the hymnal if you want to use that on page 389. It's also on the screen. So enjoy. Thank you. Kids, come on down. Ron and Carrie, you get the front row seats too today.
He's
well, you're going to learn, you're going to appreciate what we have over here, you know. I've always said the seats in the front are cheaper, you know, and yeah. How are you guys doing today?
Good.
What is new in your lives?
Went to a water park yesterday
in Lincoln? In Grand Island. Oh, the Grand Island one. That's pretty cool. You like that, don't you?
Yeah.
You like the water.
What else? What else is new?
We just went camping.
You went camping? Where at?
Branched Oak.
Cool. All right. Yes, Dawson?
Bob in my head.
You what?
Bob in my head.
Your head is new. Yeah. I know. Is that a haircut or what? You know? You got the wild thing going there is what you got. Yeah. Yeah. Except you need a black eye now.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Lyle's got the black eye going thing. You know, I don't know where he's at, but he's got that thing going. So, yeah. What do you got? You're moving to Lincoln. Cool. Where do you live now?
In New York.
In York? And you're going to go to Lincoln? Oh, that'll be exciting. New school, new friends, new places. Yeah. York's a great place, too, but you're going to like Lincoln. That'll be great. Cool. What else is new? Kinsley, what's new with you? Nothing? Yeah, the cats. The cats. The ones with worms, right? Yeah, how are they doing? Good? Okay, you got them treated and they're all good? Kinsley got cats from her neighbor. Yeah. And that's been an adventure for them. All right. Anything else new? Yes. Your cousin is getting baptized today. She is. She's really little, isn't she? Yeah. You dyed your hair red. Did you do that on your own or have it done? Or your grandma did it? Cool. I like it. I like it. It looks good. I'm kind of partial to the red hair. I like that. Yeah.
Getting a new game that came out a long time ago has been, well, I don't know how to say it. I'm getting a new game.
All right. So is it a video game?
Yeah, it's a horror game.
A horror game?
He likes them. He's playing one this morning.
Yeah.
You like the horror games? Oh, my gosh. Wow, they give me bad dreams, the horror stuff. I can't watch Wizard of Oz in its entirety. I'm sorry, those flying monkeys are scary, you know? I mean, they just are, you know? Yeah. Cool, anything else you want to share this morning? This is great. Kinsley? A new client, is that number four? Five. Four or five? Okay, Kinsley, you are his accountant and campaign manager here. You got to keep track of his clients, so, you know, so we know what's going on. Yeah, yeah. So Dawson's in the dog poop business. If you need your dog poop picked up, he comes and does that for a small fee. And so a little shout out for him there. Okay, any of you familiar with Extreme Makeover? I mean, what do you know about it? What do you know about Extreme Makeovers?
I've heard of it, but I don't know what it is.
Don't know what it is? Okay. Well, there's a couple different kinds. One kind is where they come in and they redo, where people come in and redo your house, you know, and you leave, and they come in and they totally tear your house apart and redo it, and you get back home and it's totally redone and totally different, like you never do before. They call that an extreme makeover. Another type of makeover is if you want to change your appearance, right? And so you go into, and makeup artists and coaches and different people do extreme things. Maybe you need to lose some weight, and so you get a training coach and you get a nutritionist to tell you how you should eat, and then you have someone that takes a look at your hair and says, you know, you look really good with those blue eyes. You look good with red hair. We ought to do a little tint there, you know. And others, you know, other times when said, you know, you look really good in a neon green shirt. We got to do that with your blonde hair. That'd be really good, you know. And yeah, And it's kind of an extreme, you know, maybe a hair change color or a haircut or who knows? I mean, who knows what else? Extreme makeover. So what's the goal of an extreme makeover? What do we hope happens in the end, Dawson?
Make something and someone look better.
Make them look better. Feel better. Right? Work better. Just better, better, better. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly right. So our scripture lesson today is kind of like that, because what happens is Jesus encounters this guy, this dude, and he has been possessed by demons. And so for us, that would mean that he has some mental issues going on, and he's a little scary. You know, like maybe one of the people in your horror video game type thing, a little scary to deal with. And, you know, and maybe we don't want to be around him. And, in fact, he was kind of yelling and screaming and going after people. And he came after Jesus and his disciples. And the community around him had put him in some handcuffs and chains to make sure that he couldn't hurt anybody else. And he came after Jesus and his disciples, and he wanted to fight him. He was looking for a fight. And his disciples, which would be me and you, you know, were scared to death of this guy. And Jesus just stood there and confronted him. And what he did was he recognized that he had demons within inside of him. He had some stuff going on inside that God needed to take care of. And so he made that happen on the spot. And he said, demons, you need to come out of him. God loves this person. And we're going to change his life. And so it just immediately, and Jesus has his power to do that. Immediately, the demons came out of this person, his body and his soul, and he became a new person. It was an extreme makeover. And he wanted to follow Jesus after that, which who wouldn't? You know, this person that did this for you, going, I'm with you, I'm going to follow you. And Jesus said, no, I need you to go home to your family, and you take care of them. And you share what's happened to your family and your friends and all those around you. And share the word of God and God's love with them. And so that's kind of what God calls us to do too. Sometimes we get, you know, something going on. You know, do your parents ever call you a little devil or a little demon? Or do you ever say the devil made me do it? You know, you ever do that? You know, that's kind of a common. Yeah, there's some smiles here. Nobody's fessing up. But Yeah. But sometimes we need to realize that what we do matters, what we do counts, that God wants us to be the good person, and that God's always there for us, no matter what. Okay, no matter how we feel, no matter how down in the dumps we get, that God's always there for us and be okay. Okay? Would you pray with me? Hold your hands and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for being with me and letting me share you with others. Amen. You guys are great. You guys are great. I have cookies. This is what Ryan's been waiting for, is the cookies. Okay, there's not very many of these left. They're the fireworks ones. Here are some double ones. There's fruity snacks in there if you'd rather have that. Oh, sorry, the fireworks ones are gone. Okay, you get a best second choice, whatever that might be. There you go. Okay. Sean, I just gave your cookie away, so you don't have to see those. Okay, all right. I'm going to ask Braxley to come up and to bring her family that she needs to for baptism. Denise, come and give us some water. And I'm going to ask you to join me. I think it's on page 39, isn't it? Let me make sure I got the page number right. Yes, I do. Yeah, so if you'll join me on page 39 here a little bit. Okay, Braxley, come see me. Yeah. How come your face is so red? Huh? How come your face is so red? Yeah, hi. Okay, how old is Braxley?
6 weeks.
6 weeks? Yeah, 6 weeks old, aren't you? Yeah. Yeah. Gayla? Held a baby lately? You are now. Gayla represents our congregation in taking care of this child. Because it takes more than parents to raise a child. It takes a whole village. And it takes a church. And it takes all of us to reach out and make a difference. And it gets so easy for us to be judgmental of kids and go, they shouldn't be running around. They shouldn't be noisy. They shouldn't. You know, we'll talk about that in the message a little bit too, but that's not what it takes. It takes us to be supportive and say, you know what, we remember when there were those nights you're in the rocking chair at 2 o'clock in the morning trying to calm a baby or to feed them. Or there were those nights when we were out driving the streets trying to figure out where our teenager was and what happened. And there's, you know, all those. It takes a village. It takes a village. So, Ryan, where are you working at now?
I'm at Pet Source and Sewer.
At Pet Source and Sewer, that's a cool place to be. Yeah, they're expanding and growing. And yeah, yeah, okay. Cool. And Brandy, you're at
Amigos.
All right. I see Brandy in the drive-up window every now and then. Yeah. Yeah, well, thanks for being with us today. Having Braxley baptized, this is way cool. I've got some vows for you guys today, okay? And as Gayla holds Braxley for us, and then we'll be baptizing her, okay? Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. And so today, we are baptizing Braxley Renee Billington. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture Braxley in Christ's holy church, and that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself and to profess her faith openly and lead a Christian life? Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include Braxley now before you in your care? Continuing on page 42. God, pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and she who receives it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Okay. All right. Gayla, you must be doing something right.
She's just happy over here.
She's happy. She is a happy baby. Yeah. Okay.
Got her.
Here we go. We're on a roller coaster ride. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't she sweet? 6 weeks old. Oh, my gosh. And she's, 2 nights ago, she slept clear through the night. Didn't wake mom and dad up at all, so she's been an easy baby for them to take care of. Yeah, found a fan, didn't you? Yeah, that's pretty cool to look at. have a towel for Braxley that says Braxley Renee Billington, baptized 6/19/2022, Raymond United Methodist Church. Yeah, thank you to Sally for that. She's really good at doing that for us. Okay. Braxley Renee Billington, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. May you become and remain a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome Braxley into the kingdom of God. We've got sponsors for her, so it's important for you guys to watch over her as well. Do everything we need to do. The towels for you guys to take home. There's a certificate here that you want to hang on to that says she's been baptized. Yeah. So thank you, and thank you to her family for being here for this event and for celebrating afterwards. I know you got a luncheon type thing going on. That'll be great. That'll be fun. So thanks for doing that. All right. Good job, you guys.
Would you please stand for the reading of Scripture? As Pastor explained, we have an extreme makeover. This is Luke chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. They landed in the region of Gerasenes across from Galilee. When Jesus stepped out on the shore, a certain man from the city met him. The man was possessed by demons and had not worn clothes for a long time. He would not stay in a house, but lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he shouted, fell in front of him, and said in a loud voice, "Why are you bothering me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you not to torture me." Jesus ordered the evil spirit to come out of the man. The evil spirit had controlled the man for a long time. People had kept him under guard. He was chained hand and foot, but he would break the chains. Then the demon would force him to go into the desert. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He answered, "Legion," meaning 6,000. Many demons had entered him. The demons begged Jesus not to order them to go out into the bottomless pit. A large herd of pigs were feeding on a mountainside. The demons begged Jesus to let them enter those pigs, so he let them do this. The demons came out of the man and went into the pigs. Then the herd rushed down the cliff into the lake and drowned. When those who had taken care of the pigs saw what had happened, they ran away. They reported everything in the city and the countryside. The people went to see what had happened. They came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone out, dressed and in his right mind. He was sitting at Jesus' feet. The people were frightened. Those who had seen this told the people how Jesus had restored the demon-possessed man to health. Then all the people from the surrounding region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave because they were terrified. Jesus got into a boat and started back. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged him, "Let me go with you." But Jesus sent the man away and told him, "Go home to your family and tell them how much God has done for you." So the man left. He went through the whole city and told people how much Jesus had done for him. This is the word of God for you and I, God's people.
Thanks be to God.
There's a story from an author by the name of John Killinger really powerful story. It talks about a man who was all alone in a hotel room in Canada. And he was just extremely depressed. He was so depressed, he couldn't even bring himself to go downstairs and get anything to eat. He didn't leave the room. He couldn't do anything. Now, this was a CEO of a major shipping company. He had lots of things going for him. He had lots of responsibilities. But he also had lots of blessings in his life that was going for him. But he was absolutely overwhelmed by the pressures and the demands that life had put around him. And he lied there in a lonely hotel bed, a long ways from home, wallowing in self-pity. All of his life, he'd been pretty astute, but he'd also was the kind of guy that worried and about everything. I mean, he was anxious, he was fretful, he was always fussing and stressing over every detail. And now, at midlife, his anxiety had gotten the best of him, even to the extent where it was difficult for him to sleep or to eat. He worries and broods and agonizes about everything, his business, his investments, his decision, his family, his health, even his dogs. I mean, you know what that's like, to worry. When life gets you down, all of a sudden the whole rug goes out from underneath you and you worry about everything. And he has bounced off that crater of that we know as the bottom of life, just unable to leave his room, lying in his bed. And so he's in self-pity, he starts thinking to himself, man, life isn't worth living this way. I wish I were dead. So then, you know, in this process, he starts thinking about some things, and for some reason the thought came into his head. He said, I wonder what God would think about me right now in this situation if he heard me talking this way. And so he spoke out loud and said, God, this is a joke, isn't it? Life is just a joke. And suddenly it occurred to him for the very first time that he hadn't really talked to God since he was a little kid. He really didn't have a prayer life. And it's been a long time since he really talked to God. So he sat silent for a moment and he began to pray. And he describes it like this. He said, I just talked out loud about what a mess my life was in and how tired I was and how much I wanted things to be different in my life. And you know what happened next? A voice. I heard a voice say, it doesn't have to be this way. It doesn't have to be this way. That's all he heard. That's what he got out of this whole thing. And so he went home and he told his wife what happened and had a little conversation with her. And then he went to his brother and talked to him. And his brother was a minister at the time. You know, and he said, what do you think? You think God was speaking to me? You know? And his brother's kind of going, well, duh. You know, what do you think? Of course God was speaking to you. That's what the Bible tells us, is that it doesn't have to be this way. That's what God tells us. It doesn't have to be this way. That's the message. That's why Jesus Christ came into this world to save us. You know, because to deliver us, to free us, because it doesn't have to be this way. So a few days later, this guy called his brother and said, you were right. It really has happened. I've done it. I've had a rebirth. I'm a new guy. I've had an extreme makeover, right? Christ has turned it around for me. Well, you know, as often, I mean, we watch the altar calls sometimes and we see people commit their lives and then they wake up on Monday morning and nothing has really changed. And we wonder about that. And for him, he still had to deal with the anxiety. He was still that person. He still has to work hard, but now he has a source of strength. He has something else going on for him in his life. And so he's changed some things in his life, and now during the week he sometimes goes to the chapel that's not too far from work, and he spends a little bit of time in prayer there. He said, it clears my head. It reminds me of who I am and whose I am. And each time I sit there in that sanctuary, I think back to that day in that hotel room in Canada, and how depressed and how lonely and lost I felt. And I hear that voice saying, it doesn't have to be that way. That's what our story is about this morning, that Catherine read for us, about the demon the person that was dealing with all these demons. It does not have to be that way. Christ enters into this guy from Genesee. Wasn't a Christian, wasn't a Jew. Didn't even really know God. Christ walked into his life and said, you know, this doesn't have to be like that. Took the demons from him, turns him around, gives him a new beginning, a new start, a new birth. So this is kind of an eerie, suspenseful, frightening situation that his disciples have just, you know, encountered. Now, if you look at the story, they just come off the sea when there was this huge storm that scared the bejeebies out of them. We all know that story. They can finally get to shore, and they're so glad to be on shore. You know, they go, wow, that was incredible. I'm so glad to be back on shore and have solid foot under my ground. And then they run into this guy that wants to kill him. I mean, he comes out of the tombs. He was living in the tombs where bodies were buried. He was in chains and shackles, you know, long hair, dirty, filthy. I mean, you know, we're talking about Bigfoot here, right? I mean, something pretty scary. So the disciples, as you can imagine, would be scared to death about this. So let me ask you something. What would you have done in this situation? A perilous place, a blood-curdling moment, powerful, dangerous, berserk man charging at him. I already told you how I feel about the Wizard of Oz. I mean, get me out of here, right? I'd probably run for my life or jump back in the boat. But Jesus, with the power of God behind him, which we all have, stood there in front of this guy, held his ground, faced the madman, undaunted, unafraid, and healed him, brought peace to his troubled soul, changed him, cleansed him, turned his life around. And so here's the key. You know, don't you, that can happen for us as well. So there's a couple, three things I just want to pull out of this story for you this morning. And the first one is that you don't have to be at war with yourself. It doesn't have to be that way. Notice that in this story, the demonic, this madman, was at war with himself. He was hurting himself. He was bruising himself, injuring himself. How often do we do that? You know, Pogo, the famous guy, you know, once said, "We have met the enemy, and he is us." That is true more often than not, isn't it? There was a young father that was shopping in a supermarket one day. He had his 3-year-old son with him, and things were not going well. His son was not happy, and at three, he was raising heck all over the place. Had him in the cart and pushing the place is crowded. So he's going up and down the aisles. Little kids reaching over, knocking stuff off the shelves as he go. And his dad's picking stuff up. Then he got out of the cart somehow. He weaseled himself out of the cart, and he's running down the aisle, and he's knocking every display over that he can find. And his dad is running after him perilously, trying to pick up after him and stop him from doing that. And you could hear the dad, you know, say, "Have patience, Tommy. It won't be much longer, Tommy. It's going to be okay, Tommy. Be calm, Tommy. Hang in there, Tommy." One of the older gals, astute from an aisle away, kind of heard what was going on and was watching this. And she came over and said, "Well, I just want to compliment you. I have been watching you, and I want you to know that I really admire you and the remarkable patience that you have here with little Tommy." And he said, "Oh, but lady, you don't understand. My name, his name is Michael. I'm Tommy." Well, the point is, he started with himself, okay? I mean, 3-year-old boys are 3-year-old boys, and sure, they need to be disciplined, but he started with himself. Why create a war with yourself? Some time ago, there was a young lawyer that came to see a pastor, and he was down in the dumps at wit's end. He said, "Everything has gone wrong. I've lost confidence in my professional ability. My wife has left me. I can't get along with my children. You know, I've cut off from my parents and even my in-laws, and I'm having conflicts with my coworkers. I've been drinking heavily. Everybody has left me, and I don't blame them. I've been bitter and hostile, and I've done so many mean and cruel things, and now I have so many problems." And he said, my troubles are legion, which brings us back to this story of legion, the 6,000 demons. So he paused and he took a deep breath, you know, and he leaned forward and he said, to tell you the truth, I think all those problems and symptoms and troubles are symptoms. My real problem is I don't like myself. And that taints everything that I touch and do. He's probably right. When you're at war with yourself, when you don't like yourself, it smudges, distorts every relationship. On the other hand, when we feel good about ourselves, we're more loving, we're a little bit more patient, we're a little more tolerant of other people, more thoughtful, more gracious towards everyone we see. Even when it comes to marital stuff, I always tell people in premarital counseling, I'm going, look, you got to be comfortable with yourself before you get in a relationship and a marriage with someone else. That's not fair to them for you not to be okay with you. If you want them to be okay with you, you got to be okay with you. That's important. So you want to feel good about yourself, you want to like yourself more, you want to stop bruising and hurting yourself, you have that peace, you know, within you, then remember, you're special to God. He loves you. You're extremely valuable to Him. He claims you as His child. It's important. Don't be at war with yourself. It's got to start there. So the other thing that I want to pull out is that it doesn't have to be that way to be at war with other people either. In this story, in the 8th chapter of Luke, the madman was very much at war with other people. He'd been cast out of society. He'd been shackled. You know, he was exiled to the tombs where all the dead bodies were, constantly doing battle with other people. And here in this story, he runs out towards Jesus and his disciples looking for a fight, looking for that. Isn't it amazing how sometimes we get crossways with other people or we get estranged from them or from our families? And isn't it amazing how hostile people can get sometimes over, I don't know, over something. But what is it, you know? The headlines, just last night, I think I was looking, a woman had some kids and she was living in the neighborhood and all the neighbors were complaining because the kids were too loud. They were skateboarding in front of her house on the sidewalk. And one of the neighbors came over and said, look, I'm in my house and I can hear your kids complaining. I mean, and so she finally got so frustrated, she put up a sign on the basketball hoop in front of her house that said, my neighborhood is full of Karens. And we all know what Karens are right now. I mean, that's the buzzword of the time. If your name is Karen, I'm really sorry. Yeah. We get crossways with people and we don't even know how it happened, don't we? We don't have to be at war with other people. On 2020, a while back, they did a program called Neighbors at War. And it was showing how next-door neighbors do battle with one another, fighting one another, fussing. There was another example just a couple weeks ago of a woman who's really frustrated with her neighbor because he put one of these cameras up on the fence, pointed at her house. And she's going, it's right into our windows. I mean, you know, I can't. And so she raised the fence in front of the camera. And so he moved the camera down a little ways from the fence. And I mean, oh my gosh. When will we ever learn to befriend one another, to respect one another, to love one another, to realize that we don't all think the same? You know, and sometimes, you know, we think differently. You may have heard this story. There was a situation with a young man that's going to graduate. His name was Bill. And the tradition in the family or the culture or the neighborhood at that time was that when you graduate from high school, you get a car. And so Bill and his dad had been shopping for a car for his graduation for weeks. And about a week before graduation, they found what they thought was the perfect car. You know, it was going to be great. And so Bill graduated, and on that night, he was presented with a Bible from his mom and dad, all wrapped up. And he unwrapped that and saw that it was a Bible. And he was ticked. And he reacted. And he threw that Bible down and left and just went into a rage. And he didn't speak to his mom and dad. They'd reach out and try to contact him and try to, you know, appease the relationships and stuff. He wouldn't have anything to do with it. He wouldn't read their letters. He wouldn't respond to their calls. He estranged himself from them, all over the fact that he got a Bible for graduation instead of the car that he was expecting. So his mom and dad passed away. He went back. There was an inheritance. He went back to take care of stuff. And he was going through his dad's things, and here was this Bible. And so he kind of brushed the dirt, the dust off the top of it, and was looking through it. And he opened it up, and here's a cashier's check dated the date of his graduation for the amount of that car. Duh. Do we ever do stuff like that? Do we ever fly off the handle? Do we ever not think things through? Man, we get into so much trouble with other people. Or they get into trouble with us because of stupid things that were never meant to be that way. Isn't that sad? It's tragic. It's just a tragedy. And so I work with my own family, you know. I work with myself first. I mean, this is not just about you. This is about me too. But I work with my own family going, okay, how do we respond, not react? How do we think this through? How do we process things? How do we see things from other people's viewpoint? How do we understand that there's consequences to our responses, our choices? Because we all have choices when we wake up in the morning. How does Jesus want us to choose? What would he say? Because he's here for us, and the Bible is full of all of his stories teaching us how to live our lives and what's right and what's wrong. How do we do that? Instead of the knee-jerk gut reaction of throwing the Bible down and never talking to someone again. So, it doesn't have to be this way. We don't have to be at war with ourselves. We don't have to be at war with other people. And we don't have to be at war with God. So, this madman in the story, full of demons, is obviously cut off from God. And when Jesus approached him, if you remember what he said? He said, Jesus, what do you want with me, Son of the Most High? Why are you tormenting me? You know, like, get the hell out of my life. You ever feel that way about God? I'd invite you to rethink that, to reevaluate. Carl Michelson was a young theologian. He was really bright. He ended up being killed in an airplane accident. But there's a story about him. Now, if you've ever heard of Rachel Held Evans, she was a young theologian as well. Just wonderful. And Rachel got an aneurysm or something, and all of a sudden she was with us no more. A real tragedy. Same way with Carl. He was killed in a plane crash, and he had a lot to add to theology and how to live life. But the story is that he was playing with his young son in the front yard one day. They were messing around. His son was 3-4 years old, and they were just having a great time playing. And in the process, somehow his dad's elbow connected with young son's face and really hit him hard, you know, and just knocked the bejeebies out of him. And oh my gosh, the boy was stunned by the impact of this, and it hurt, and he was obviously about to burst into tears. But he looked up, and he saw his dad there. He looked into his father's eyes, and instead of anger or hostility, he saw that there was a whole bunch of sympathy there and compassion and concern. He somehow felt, through looking at his dad's eyes, he felt that love and compassion that he had for him. I mean, and it just changed his whole thing. At that age, just changed his whole compassion. And instead of bursting out in tears, all of a sudden he burst out in laughter. And he figured out that this is going to be okay. I can get through this. I got a dad that's going to be there for me. What he saw in his father's eyes made all the difference. Now, can you see where I'm going with this? What he saw in his father's eyes made all the difference. It's one of the reasons that Jesus is so important to us. He lets us look into his father's eyes. I mean, that's who God is for us, is Jesus. He came. He walked with us. We have the stories. He taught us how to live. We see Father God through him. And so when we look at Jesus, we see what God is like and what God wants us to be like. So, the love, the compassion, the concern, the empathy, you know, that's the good news of our faith. Have you ever noticed that they call the New Testament good news? That's the good news of our faith, is that Christ is with us and he gives us that love and compassion. We can see God through him. And not with angry, vengeful, judgmental, condemning eyes, but with eyes of love. No matter what happens in our lives, no matter how far down we are, no matter if we're bouncing off the bottom of the crater, you know, or we're feeling a little self-pity for ourselves, and if you can look at me in my eye and tell me that you've never felt that, I'm going to watch your lips and watch you lie to me. Because that's part of who we are. We get depressed and we get down and life turns around us. Me too. And what I want to remind you, life doesn't have to be that way. We don't have to be at war with ourselves. We don't have to be at war with anybody else. Even though they'd like to be at war with us. If you remember anything from my tenure here, Jan, what is it? It's not about you. It's not about you. When someone comes at you and you don't understand why, it's not about you. It's about them and what's going on in their lives. And it's about the fact that they need a little bit of love from God at that time. And you can react in hostile, angry ways, which would be totally justified, but will get you nowhere except a bad relationship. Or you can react with God's love and bite your tongue till it bleeds and go forth and say, this is what God wants me to do. Don't have to be at war with other people. I don't have to be at war with God. I know people come to me sometimes and say, I am so mad at God. And I go, and I understand. I get that. It's okay. God's got broad shoulders. It's okay to be mad at him once in a while. Life happens around us and some really, really bad things happen. But you don't have to be at war with him. It doesn't have to be that way. Amen. This is our time for sharing our joys and our concerns and lifting them up to God as a group of believers. What are your joys and your concerns this morning as we worship together? What's her first name again?
Lynn.
Okay, so for Lynn and dealing with, she's on a cancer journey, and now she's in South Carolina and a long ways away, and so we're concerned for her. So we ask that God would be part of her life and she might feel his presence through this journey. For this we pray.
Lord, hear us.
Larry and Mary Hardesty, 65 years today. You can stop in if you want, open house at the Women's Club. That's pretty cool. That's pretty. And Larry and Mary are just wonderful. I've so enjoyed them, so that's been great. For this we pray. Pam?
Pam's going to be 52 on Saturday, June 25th.
Wow. That's this coming Saturday. You've got a birthday coming, 52 years old. Happy birthday to you, Pam. That'd be great. That'd be great. Good job.
We're celebrating all month.
Well, I would. I'd celebrate for a couple months. Pam, you hold them to it. Don't let them, you keep them celebrating for your birthday. Yeah. For this we pray.
Lord, hear us.
56 years of marriage for Jerry and Glenn Dean. That's incredible. If you've ever been around Jerry, that's really incredible. That is, it's great, and they're sharing that with us. For this we pray.
Lord,
other joys in Jackie. Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay. Cool, yeah. She's got several weddings in her life right now, so yeah.
Yeah, we got one this next Saturday, too. Stephanie, Beth Bill's daughter.
I've heard about that one, yeah. I might be there.
Yeah.
For weddings and for new life and new beginnings. For this we pray. Others. Yes.
Yesterday we celebrated the Stearns family reunion. For 96 years, we've had an annual Stearns reunion, and it's still going on.
That's amazing. Where was it at?
We held it at Bethany Park in Lincoln.
Cool. Cool. That Stearns family just reaches out a whole lot. I've discovered this. Learned to keep my mouth shut. You know, it reaches out a lot of different ways. Yeah. Yeah, but there's more than one. She's got two or three,
okay.
You know, in the next month. So, yeah. Yeah, for the Stearns family, for their reunion, for all families, as we gather together and we celebrate our presence together. For this we pray.
Lord,
Greg? Nothing more amazing than watching your children succeed, is there? You know, and good things for them. And so Lauren's been involved in Job's Daughters, and she's Miss Congeniality this year, and has been
trying.
Not anymore?
Yeah, that's the transition.
Oh, yeah. Well, up till now. Yeah. So it's been a good year for her. And so we're glad for that and for her presence in that and what that's done for her. For this we pray.
Lord,
Cindy? Oh, cool. Well, I know Greg is following them and supporting them immensely all the time. And so you were honored with that, with an award for that. Good for you. That's great. So we're thankful for Greg and his presence here with us and what he does in that back corner that you never know about, as well as what he does for his family and supporting the Job's Daughters things. Because Sophie's going that same route, isn't she?
Yeah, she's involved, but maybe not to the extent.
Okay, yeah. For this we pray.
First, when my sister came on, she fell and suffered about going to the doctor, so she's going tomorrow, but I don't think she'll continue helping us with my neighbors. So we need a prayer for her if somebody has just a little bit of time to help us.
Okay, for Janan, who slipped and fell this last week, that she'll feel God's presence with her and healing for her. For this we pray.
Lord,
Bob?
For a very successful retirement party.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for all those that were involved in the retirement party, that would, you know, Ann and I talked afterwards. That couldn't have gone any better for us. I mean, we were just thrilled with how that came out and what happened, and so that was fun. If you didn't make it, we can have another one. Let me know. We'll plan, because that was fun. And so, yeah. Yeah, Larry?
Joy, for all the times that you came over to Melton Church and helped us out. And
yeah.
The funerals that you did for our family. And a concern for the people of the Ukraine as they fight for their freedom.
Okay, you've got a whole lot in there. You got a whole lot in there.
One end to the other.
Yeah, one in the, it's been fun to be part of the Malcolm Church and to fill in there now and then. And we work back and forth, and that's been worked out wonderful for both of our congregations. And so I hope that continues into the future and that that works out. That's been good. The Ukraine is a tough deal. And so our prayers are with all that are involved in that. And it doesn't have to be that way. You know, it doesn't have to be that way. But we get crossways with each other somehow. And so our prayers are for all those that are in the crosshairs and crossways in the Ukrainian tragedy. For this we pray. Aaron, okay. Aaron is Kim's nephew, so he was Marlene's son, and he's in Colorado now, and he's works IT at schools, is my understanding, is kind of, you know, what he does, but he's been dealing with brain cancer for several years, and it's actually kind of a walking miracle, because brain cancers can be pretty brutal, and doesn't usually last that long. He's been doing really well with it, and so they're finding, they continue to check him, and with his imaging, and they're finding something in there that they don't like, but they're not sure what's going on. Whether it's actual cancer growing or whether it's the result of radiation, some chemo. And so they're watching that. And so our prayers are with him in his cancer journey and in this spot that he's dealing with, and that he'll feel God's presence with him as he goes forward. And we pray for God's healing. If you know Kim, you know she has this huge garden, and it's not just a garden, but she creates spices from that and different things, and sells those and helps supplement her farm income. And this last week, her garden got flattened, and so people are coming up with plants for her and encouragement and support. Yeah. This hail's been pretty devastating, and you know, so you got it a week ago Tuesday. And Seward, we got it on this last Tuesday. Every field that I farm was affected. I got it everywhere. If you look at our Jeep out front, it's peppered. The house is peppered. And yet, it's not as bad as some. Big question for farmers is, you know, what do we do? The insurance adjusters say you have to wait 10 days before we're going to tell you what to do. You know, and that's really frustrating, because we're already late planning. If we have to replant, we need to do it now. And I need a new battery. So it's just really a frustrating time. So yesterday for me, I looked at all of my stuff or the worst stuff with an expert agronomist and determined that your replanting is not going to do any good. What's there is what's there. And so it'll be a yield loss and a yield reduction, but at least I don't have to worry about going back out and tearing it up and replanting. Take care of what you got. That's not true for everybody. Thank you, Greg. Some people will have to replant. And you look at some fields and it just makes you sick. I mean, there's nothing left. It's just bare ground. And others, there's a corn stalk every 3 foot. And it's, yeah. But we love this farming game. We love the farm. We love that. And it's all part of it. And God has always provided. It'll be okay.
Ah. And actually, Cliff happens to be my husband's cousin. Everybody's related.
you're starting to make me think I'm in Arkansas. Okay, so for all those celebrations, for the blessings that we have, you know, we are blessed. I mean, and obvious, sometimes we just got to point them out to one another. You know, that, hey, you know, life, it could be worse. Life can be worse. And we're blessed. So thank you, God, for that. For this we pray. Take 30 seconds. Sean, give us 30 seconds. There are things that are heavy on your mind, deep in your soul, troubling stuff that you can't share because it wouldn't be appropriate. But it's working on you. Take 30 seconds and just give that to God. He's promised, you know, it may not take the pain away, but he's promised to be with us no matter what. Just share that with him. Join me in our prayer of confession. Lord of the ages, in our busy lives, we do not always make time to love, to pray, or to sing your praises. We want to be strong, yet we often feel out of control. Joining together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I want to take a moment to welcome some people into the membership of our congregation. They have been around a long time, and they've said, yeah, we want to transfer in, but we've never really acknowledged that officially or publicly, and so I want to do that. And that's Don and Bev Hamill in front here, and also Ron and Carrie Bowens. We wouldn't know that they're not members because they've been here and they've been active and faithful, but they've just never done it officially. And so at this time, I want to welcome you into the official membership of the Raymond United Methodist Church, all the privileges and duties and responsibilities that entails, including proclaiming Jesus Christ as your Savior and living a life like that, and including supporting the church with your time, your talents, and your finances, you know. And time and talents is important. You know, the things that we have, that we can do, our presence here in worship and everywhere else. And I have for you these wonderful mugs to present to you. If you drop them, they will break. I have experience. But they are way cool. They're the larger ones, and they are way cool. So welcome into the official membership of our church and of the congregation. So Don and Bev and Ron and Carrie, there's an offering plate on the table in the back. And for everyone, there's the offering plates on the table in the back. If you're able to give, thank you so much for supporting this ministry that we have here in this church, because we do some phenomenal stuff. And it's because you support it that we're able to do that. And so thanks for your support. And just, you know, and you just have to trust me on this. It feels good to give to God. It just does. I mean, it might be painful to write that first check, but it feels good to give to God. You just have to trust me on this and try it. It's amazing. And the thing I want to point out is that even though what you give it might look like a little bit, when God blesses it, who knows what's going to happen, because it has God's power behind it. And so what you give is important, no matter how much that is. So just keep that in mind. I would ask you to stand and sing Give Thanks with me. And the left arms of Jesus Christ and God our Father. What happens in this on this earth and in our lives is because of what we do when we reach out. When people see God's face in our face, when they look into our eyes and see love and compassion instead of anger, that's who you and I are. And that's who Christ calls us to be. So as you leave this place, remember that God goes with you. That you're never alone. That Christ is in your back pocket. And that you have the power within that that is like no other. I know sometimes we forget. And sometimes we go on with life. And sometimes we take things for granted. My job is to point out to you that God is there. Your job is to be aware of that and make something happen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is... the Spirit song, which we sang part of earlier, but this will be in its entirety. It's one of my favorite songs. Thank you. today. Thank you for watching us online, if you're worshiping with us in that way. For those that are here, Paul Newkirk is here from Seward. Welcome to you. He's a friend of mine that has come. And the girls from York, some of Jane's China friends, and some different people. We got the Minnesota people, the South Dakota people, we got the Lutherans and the Catholics, and we got it all. So thanks for being here. Now, last week will be my last Sunday preaching with you, and so you can expect both barrels, all right? Because what are you going to do, fire me? Okay. So just be prepared for that, all right? Thanks for being here, and grab some coffee and some lunch.